Hey there, it's Killwave. If you haven't seen my previous video, I highly advise you check it out because it's my first speed paint, and you'd probably get a very good impression about how this is gonna be this time around. So, check it out if you have the time. If you don't want to, that's fine too. I don't really care. So, if you're watching this video, it's your lucky day because I will be explaining my creative process. Well, to the best of my ability. It's really hard to put into words the artistic process, the creative process, any kind of process, whenever it just happens. You just do the thing. So I'm hoping I can actually articulate it well enough that it actually makes some form of sense for everyone. Without further ado, let's jump into it, I suppose. Ah, the rough sketch. The foundation of the entire picture. So with this, I usually do a very messy, rough sketch, It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how messy it is. It doesn't matter how clean it is. This is mostly just to block out the forms and to get everything looking appropriate, at least, and the composition down. I usually do this to check the proportions and whether or not a character is leaning, because that's a big thing. That's a big m beginner mistake is the lean on a character. Lean can be taken care of just by using the transform tool and just kind of adjusting the rotation, and that really helps. If something looks off after you've changed the rotation and fixed the lean, you can easily just use the wand tool, transform tool, and just fix any kind of weird proportion you got going on. It makes it a lot easier to do it that way. And if the first draft of your rough sketch isn't that perfect, I don't even fuss. Because sometimes I can do a rough sketch over and over again, sometimes up to like 5 or more times, just to get, a good pose down or whatever. If something doesn't look great and I just want to scrap the whole thing, I just do it. I scrap it all sometimes. It's just how I work. But usually whenever I'm satisfied with this rough sketch, if it looks good enough, then I can use it to move on to my line art. But if not, and like in this case of this picture, if not, then I will do a new layer and then do a cleaner sketch over it so I can actually see the details and know what I'm looking at. This process could take the most amount of my time or the least amount of my time. It just depends on if I already have the idea in my head of what I'm doing or not. Sometimes it takes me longer to do it. Even though it can take me a while, it's still a very important process of the entire thing. So, when it comes to line art, I always make a new layer for that, of course, and I usually do a smooth or a textured brush with this. I don't do the method that a lot of artists do, which is to zoom in really close on the canvas, start doing little bitty parts of the line bit by bit. I mean, it comes out looking really great. It's like really crisp and smooth lines and all that, but it's very time consuming and very tedious, and I do not have the patience for that. So what I do is I kind of zoom out a bit, as you could probably see in this video, and I do longer sweeping strokes. And this actually, it actually helps me because it's not as tedious. That's for freaking sure. But it also allows me to see the entirety of the picture instead of just a portion of it. I'll clean up any of the flyaway lines, any edges, or clean up any edges and make them smooth. Clean up any of the line thickness issues that go along with doing it in this method. It doesn't take as much time, and I find it is very intuitive and it very fluid, basically. I like doing it a lot. Typically, I'll use a stark black color, like an absolute black, and then later, if I want to change the color, I'll just simply make a new layer over the line art layer and set it to clipping group. And with this, I can change the color to anything that I want to. I can even use gradients. I can change it up a little bit. Again, it's actually a good method to use if you want to do colored line art. So you keep the integrity of your line art and you don't have to do the whole opacity lock. And if you can play around with it all you want to, and if you're not satisfied, all you got to do is just delete the layer that's set to clipping group. And there you go. You have your line art the same as it was before you started messing with it. It's hard to go into really deep detail about how I do line art since it's such a simple method, really. I don't really know how to explain it any further, other than the fact that I do those long sweeping motions and my line art comes out relatively smooth. Wait a minute, hold on. I know what I can say. The stabilizer. Most art programs, at least, have a stabilizer for lines. This actually helps with the shakiness of it. If you put the stabilizer up, then it'll smooth out the lines for you, so it'll get those kinks out of there. I usually keep my stabilizer set to 15 in Psi and Psi 2, depending on what I want to use. I don't think I really use a stabilizer in anything else like Clip Studio or with Medibang. But seriously, if you want to get the shakiness out of your lines, just up the stabilizer. There's nothing wrong with using it. It actually helps you instead of hinders you. It's a really neat setting, and check it out if you haven't already. Alright, so moving on to the process that usually takes me the longest, and usually it takes a lot of people the longest, honestly, it depends. But that part is coloring! Woo! I honestly like this part of the process a lot because I can experiment with color and lighting and just have a field day with it. So usually I do a base color to start off with. The base color being usually like skin tone or the main color of the character, depending on if I'm doing furry or if I'm doing human. Usually it's like the main fur color or for furries, or the basic skin tone of the character if it's not. So first off, I will select the negative space around the line art, which is all the empty space around the character if there is any, including any of the areas kind of landlocked between like arms or legs or something, and then I will inverse that selection, start a new layer and underneath the line art, and then use the bucket tool to fill in the base color. Sometimes if I'm not using a skin tone or a fur color or main color or whatever, I will just use gray, a nice in-between kind of middle tone gray, just so I can use that as a basis. And then the rest of the coloring is quite the process. So every part of the character of the whole entire picture, every single bit of it, like the clothing, the hair, and the other details on the skin and the body, all of that will be on their own separate layer, set to clipping group to the base color layer. Why do I do this, you ask? Well, there's a good reason for it. The best reason I can give you is that it makes changing the colors super easy. All you have to do is either use the hue and color slider or whatever you call it. I don't know what to call it, I just call it the hue slider. I'll use that, or I will just simply alpha lock the layer that I want the color to be changed and just fill it in myself by hand with the pen tool or something, or just add different colors to it or whatever. This is actually really handy and it saves you a lot of time, trust me. It'll save you a lot of time in the long run and you'll probably be very thankful for this method. It makes the coloring process go a lot smoother. Now, I'm gonna let you in on a little secret. I did not go to art school, so I don't have the, I guess you can say, a professional explanation to color theory, and I don't really know how to explain it all myself. I just have this basic understanding of colors and what looks nice to me and what doesn't look nice, and sometimes it actually goes within color theory and all that jazz. But I highly recommend doing a Google research and just doing some research on your own time about color theory and trying to understand how color works, because that'll help you out in the long run. As far as the picture I'm doing for this video is going, this is actually a old OC of mine from back in high school. He was created in MS Paint on a whim one day at a friend's house. I really like the look of pink and brown together, so that's why he's got pink and brown hair and he's got that darker skin tone. And I don't know why I gave him purple eyes or a blue jacket, honestly, but that is about as close to the original incarnation of this character as I can get from my memory. He always had that really long kind of white and black striped scarf because, you know, what is back in those days, everybody has those phases. I'm still going through phases, honestly. That's just how life goes. So after the initial coloring is done, I usually make a new layer for the shading. Shading is a bit complicated. Sometimes it can be very complicated, but the main thing to keep in mind whenever you're doing shading, what I like to keep in mind, is the light source. Sometimes you can do one light source or you can do multiple. In this case, I just did one just to make it easier on myself, but I usually like to keep that in mind. And if I have trouble remembering where I put the light source, I will just kind of draw a little yellow circle somewhere on a new layer of where it should be, and that'll help me as kind of a guideline while I do the shading. You probably noticed that I start off doing the shading with a very light color and then kind of block it out and smooth it. I do a combination of cell shading and soft shading. It gives this like really cool look. The soft shading will actually give that kind of curved round look to things, and the cell shading will give kind of that harsher, a lot cleaner shadow look to certain areas where the roundness isn't really necessary. The lighter color is just so I can see what I'm doing, but I will keep a lighter color typically. After I'm done blocking out the shadows, I usually set it to multiply, and then I'll use the hue slider to change it up as need be. Here it started off as like a lighter green, I think, and then I changed it to maybe like a purple or a magenta. I think it was like a pinky color, really. So yeah, that's what I do in this process. It gives the character more depth, and it doesn't make it look as flat and as harsh and muddy colors as you would if you used a gray or a black to shade things. Speaking of using black and stuff, do not use black to shade your pictures. And please do not use the burn tool. The burn tool will muddy up those colors something fierce and just make it look absolutely terrible. You can use it if you want to, but use it very sparingly. Do not use it as your primary source of shading. It'll just make your art look so terrible. And I can guarantee you, if you do this other method with the lighter color and a actual colored shading and set it to multiply, it'll make it look a lot better. It took me a while to learn that over time, because I actually started out doing digital art when I was around 12 years old, and I was definitely using that burn tool for shading. But the older I got, the more I learned about digital art and all that stuff, and I learned how to properly shade and to do shading in a different way, and from then on I've just been experimenting with it ever since. Now after the shading, I do my finishing touches. Usually if I'm doing the background as a simple thing like this, I'll use some kind of texture and then some colors and some color gradients, and whoop whoop doo, there you go, it looks pretty neat in the end. Sometimes I'll even put an overlay on top of the everything and some gradient colors just to give it a little extra oomph to it. I don't think I did it in this picture. I didn't do that. But yeah, sometimes I do it, and it actually looks pretty damn neat. So that, my friends, is my entire process from beginning to end. I hope that was somewhat articulated well. Probably not. I hope you can understand it, though. I hope that you may have learned a few things. Before I go, I kind of wanted to cover something else that was suggested that I cover in a video, and that is, what is my favorite things to draw? Well, that's simple. I love drawing characters, as you can probably tell. Characters are my absolute favorite thing to draw, from portraits to full bodies. It's just really fun. Characters are always so expressive, and I love drawing expressive things. It doesn't have to be humans either. It can be furries or monsters, what have you. Just characters in general. If you enjoyed this video, give it a like. If you want to see more, then hit that subscribe button and click the little notification bell so you can get notified of the next videos. If you're one of those awesome people that like to support artists, you can check out my Patreon, which will be listed down below in the description, as well as links to all my galleries such as DeviantArt and VerAffinity. And last but not least, what's your process like? I would like to know. Tell me about it. You can tell me about it in the comments below, and I'd love to hear from you. Have a fantastic day, and I will see you soon.